Hey, brothers and sisters. Hope you guys are doing all right. I was just thinking while I was sitting here starting to make this video that several of the people I met in person, they told me that I look younger in person than I do on my videos. Well, you know, some people are photogenic, and I guess I'm not a photogenic person. But anyway, God bless you guys. I just wanted to go through and pray and get a word for some people. The Lord had told me something, and I can't remember what it is now. I just got through praying, but I'd started a new list. People to pray for. Got another new list. Oh, there it is. I better work off the old list first. I ask you guys, as I always say, to pray with me in agreement. Prayer is outside of time, right? So when you pray with me, even though you may pray an hour from now or a day from now, God still sees it all at the same time. So I need you guys' help. You know, as the Bible says, one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. So we as a group can really get it done, brothers and sisters. So let's pray. Sorry, 1 second. While I'm thinking about it, if the Lord tarries and the world's still standing in May, I'll be flying to the States. I've got a vehicle I've got to pick up in Dallas. I'll only be in Dallas a few days, I think. Not sure yet, but it looks like I'll be, I know that I'll be in Philadelphia area. I will be in the Philadelphia area Memorial Day weekend, the last weekend in May. So if you, I'm trying to get it scheduled now because I'm still trying to work on my plan. It's fluid. I got to get down there with Brother Sid, who's doing the website, you know, the ministry portion of the website of the Church of the Firstborn. The link is below here. We're going to start, by the grace of God, if the Lord tarries, a weekly broadcast, at least a weekly broadcast of a blog talk radio, a live sermon, and then questions and answers and things like that, a radio show. And Brother Sid and I is going to be doing it. Brother Sid will be producing it and handling the chat room and all that stuff. We've got to work it out. Anyway, he lives in South Carolina, so I'm planning on getting down there too in June, first week of June, by the grace of God, and be down there for a while, I guess, in that area, maybe for the summer. Still praying about it. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask if you are in the anywhere near Philadelphia and you would like to come to the hotel, the places I go to, like in Dallas and different places I went, I stayed in the hotel, let people come and meet me in the conference room of the hotel. Much better than me going around to people's houses and stuff. I can see a whole lot more people and get a lot more effective for the Lord. So that's why I ask you, if you're in the Philadelphia area, around there, I'm going to be near a place called Media. If you're going to be in that area, contact me. I want to see you. Like Saturday night, that will be May the 24th. Yes, Saturday, May the 24th. And if I will stay for more days in Philadelphia, if people want to see me on the Sunday, the 25th, also let me know. I'll be available if people are going to want to see me. Anyway, God bless you guys. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, we come to you right now, Father, by your grace, by your mercy. Lord, you said you have not given us a spirit of fear, but a power and of love and a sound mind. So I keep hearing from the Lord, you know, being of sound mind. And, you know, it's like for a last will and testament. Of course, that's what the Bible tells us. You know, I've talked about this before. The New Testament doesn't really begin until really Jesus is announcing the kingdom of heaven is at hand in the Gospels. He lived under the law as a rabbi, under the law. And he obeyed the law. He kept the law. He was without sin. Now, the Bible tells us in Hebrews that a New Testament begins. It's like when you write your last will and testament. It goes into effect when the testator dies, the death of the testator. So that's why we have, you know, the testaments. That's why it's called the New Testament. And the Old Testament is the death of those animals. The New Testament is the death of our Lord and Savior, who is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So while I was praying, and just as I was about to pray, I heard in my head, you know, I heard the Lord saying, you know, I, the Lord Jesus Christ, being of sound mind, just like you write at the beginning of a will. Now I remember what the Lord told me when I was praying just a few minutes ago. Maybe I look older on my videos because I always make videos about midnight. It's midnight here. I mean, you know, that's me. That's my schedule because I'm so busy with the ministry here, and not just what I do here in the Philippines, not even counting the internet stuff with all you guys, the Facebook and all that. Anyway, this is what the Lord told me. He told me that I'm preparing a place for you, which we already know that, right? In my Father's house are many mansions. The Lord gave me that text. He is preparing a place for us, and where He is, we shall be also. That text is also a rapture text, brothers and sisters. I did a video a long time ago, and I put up a list, but people said they couldn't see it good, comparing Bible verses, the second coming of Christ, brothers and sisters. Every eye shall see Him, okay? As the lightning shines from the east, so shall, and flashes to the west, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. The Lord Jesus Christ will descend to the earth. He will land on the Temple Mount, or He will land up there at the Mount of Olives, and it will split in two. There'll be an earthquake, and He'll walk right in there into Jerusalem. And that the rapture, we meet Him in the air. He goes to His Father's house to prepare a place for us, John chapter 14. In my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you so. I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come and take you to myself, and where I am, you will be there also. And like in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, 17, 18, it says, the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. To meet the Lord in the air. Thus shall we forever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. We will be with the Lord forever. We're going to meet Him in the air. Later on, after the tribulation, the Lord returns to earth with 10,000 of His saints. He comes down to earth with His saints. It's not at the same time. I've been through this. I'm going to pray for people, but the Lord is leading me to talk about this. Hey, what can I do? When Jesus comes back to earth, in Matthew chapter 25, He said He would judge the sheep and the goats. The people on earth, He'll say, when I was naked, You clothed me. That reminds me about the orphans and stuff. When I was hungry, You fed me. When I was sick, You visited me. You know, You prayed for me. When I was in prison, You visited me. Okay, all those things. And so He separates the sheep and the goats. So if the rapture were to happen just 5 minutes before the Lord returns to earth, who would be the sheep? All the sheep would have been caught up to meet Him in the air and then turn right around and come right back down with Him. It doesn't make any sense. Land on the earth just 1 minute later. Here we are on earth. And then the Lord's going to take all the people that's still on the earth and say, okay, you're a goat, you're a sheep, you're a goat, you're a sheep. If those people were some of them were sheep, why weren't they raptured? If the rapture was just at that same time. That's just one of a thousand examples of simple even human logic to understand that the rapture is pre-tribulation. As the Lord said, He would come as a thief in the night. The second coming can be calculated. We know that it's 7 years from the time that the tribulation begins. It's divided. We have the 1,260 days and another 1,260 days, really, and then the extra 30 days added on there to cleanse the temple after the Lord returns. That's what that extra time is on the end of that second group of whatever it is. It ends up being, I don't have all those numbers in my head. But anyway, the second half of the tribulation, it's got like an extra 30 or 45 days on it, whatever it is. That's for the cleansing of the temple under the law. Anyway, I wasn't prepared to go through all those numbers, brothers and sisters. But anyway, it is clear that there is a pre-tribulation rapture. Let your heart not be troubled. That's from the same text. The Lord is just speaking to me now. I just realized that's also from John chapter 14. Let your heart not be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. That's the first verse of John chapter 14, the same text the Lord just gave me. This is a confirmation, it's from the Lord. And the Lord has had me say this, there must be people out there, your heart is troubled. And I know the World War III is about to begin. It seems like it's imminent. And the Lord has spoke to me that World War III is about to begin, get your house in order. Now that doesn't mean, look, we had World War II and there wasn't the rapture. Okay, they had nuclear war in World War II and it was not the rapture. They had all the Holocaust of the Jews, and it was not the rapture and tribulation, even though it was a type of the rapture, or a type of the tribulation. What happened to the Jewish people? They were tattooed by Hitler. They were killed. All those things that happened to them. Hitler was a great type of the Antichrist, or as a better way of saying, he was a bad person and a bad type of person who was a type of the Antichrist. Anyway, brothers and sisters, must be people asking about that, because that's what the Lord is pressing me to keep talking about. Let your heart not be troubled. You believe in God, you believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. That's the Lord Jesus Christ, John chapter 14. People read that sometimes like at funerals. I've done funerals, and I did lots of funerals. I don't know how many funerals. I've probably done at least 20 funerals, and I've done about 15 weddings. But at those funerals, I've done funerals with other pastors where they did part and I did part. And it seems like every funeral I've did with another pastor, they always read that text. But that is really a text that supports the pre-tribulation rapture. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've already been teaching for 10 minutes, but I'm going to go ahead and pray for people who need a word. And those who are just looking for the rapture, they'll miss that teaching. That's why I don't always label my videos with a sensational part of the video. Sometimes because I only want those who are, truly trying to be discipled to hear the stuff that the Lord gives me. I don't want to cast. It's good to give the gold nuggets to those who are hungry and thirsting after righteousness, that they would be filled. Let's begin to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, we give you the praise, we give you the glory. Right now I pray for, is that D-R-P-E-L-L-E-I-S-H-A? It's been a while since I wrote this name. I think that's a D. Delicia. I remember writing down your name because it's kind of a unique name. Father, right now we pray for Delicia in Jesus' name, Lord Father. We ask you to bless her, Father. Wisdom. With wisdom. I hear that the Lord is going to give you wisdom. The Bible says, he who lacks wisdom, let him ask. And God loves to give it liberally. And he upbraideth it not. Excuse me. So, Delicia, wisdom, spirit of wisdom. You've been asking for wisdom, or you need wisdom, ask, and the Lord will give it to you. Or if you've been asking, he's going to give it to you. That's the Bible verse. This wisdom is what I hear from the Lord, a word of wisdom. Maybe the Lord wants to use you with the gift of wisdom, giving a word of wisdom, to give the gifts of word of wisdom. Some of the stuff I'm doing, sometimes I give people a word of knowledge, sometimes I give them a word of wisdom. A word of knowledge is, let me just do this teaching on here, a golden nugget here for you guys. A word of knowledge is like when in Acts, when the book of Acts, when Paul was at a street called Straight, Saul of Tarsus, and the Lord spoke to, Ananias, and said, there's a man who I've chosen. He's blind. He's waiting on you to come over there and lay hands on him to receive his sight. When he's in a street called Straight, I want you to go over there. The Lord told him to go over there. That is a word of knowledge. He did not know that Saul of Tarsus was there until the Lord said, boom, go over there. So he got a word of knowledge from the Lord that Saul was there waiting for him to come. And then when the Lord started telling him, he must suffer many things from me and all this stuff, like a future thing, that was a word of wisdom. A word of knowledge is, hey, the Lord just told me that you've got back pain. Okay, that's a word of knowledge. Then a word of wisdom is, by his stripes you are healed. The Lord wants me to lay hands on you and he's going to heal you. So that's a word of knowledge. And then a word of wisdom is, like if I told you, you need to spend more time in prayer. God says, that your fellowship with him is not what it should be. He wants you to spend more time in prayer. That's a word of wisdom. If I told you, oh, the Lord told me you're having marriage trouble, it's a word of knowledge. See the difference? It's like now things going on, and then wisdom is an application of the word of God in your life. Okay, that's the difference between those two. And then a straight out prophecy. The gift of prophecy in the church is a word of exhortation. Read your Bible, you'll see it right in there. I believe it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 14. It talks about, and chapter 12, those two together. Chapter 14, you will see that the gift of prophecy in the church is for exhortation of the church. In other words, someone gives a word, or as it tells us in the Bible, someone speaks in tongues and someone translates. Those two together is like two nickels that make a dime of prophecy. And then a prophecy by itself without tongues and interpretation is just a straight up it's like an interpretation without someone speaking in tongues. It's the whole thing. And then it's for exhortation. Now that's where people get confused in rightly dividing the word when they say, oh, a New Testament prophet is not supposed to rebuke anybody. No, there's the office of a prophet. First, our Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, it says he gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors, and some teachers for the perfecting of the saints. That's in the church age. All you denominational people, there are really, it's fourfold, because pastor, teacher, really, they say in the Greek, those Greek experts say that they go together as one office, pastor, teacher. Okay, and even in the King James, it's got it like, they're like together as opposed to the other ones. Anyway, those are New Testament offices. It's not just the Old Testament. And you see Agabus. There's several prophets mentioned in the book of Acts in the New Testament, like Agabus, as I mentioned, who said there would be a dearth in the land. There's a, and I believe it was him or another prophet that told Paul that he would be put in chains when he, you know, he'd be bound when he arrested when he went to Jerusalem. And even the daughters of Philip the evangelist, his daughters were prophetesses, and they'd also prophesied that Paul should not go to Jerusalem because he would be arrested there. Anyway, so the office of a prophet is someone who works as a elder slash preacher who works in all in words of wisdom, words of knowledge, and prophecy, and even and preaches and does rebuking and exhorting and all that stuff in season and out of season as any pastor or preacher does of the, any of the ministries, evangelist, teacher, pastor, prophet, or apostle, and all those things. And then the gift of prophecy, someone in the church who is not an elder, who's not a preacher, they can have any of those gifts and operate in the gift. And when they operate in the gift of prophecy in the church, stand up in the middle of the praise and worship and give a word like, I'm with you, you know, I'm coming soon to get you, blah, 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 some kind of a, you know, an exhortive word from the Lord. That is a gift of prophecy, an operation in the church, not from the preacher, but from anyone in the church. That's a whole other topic. As the Lord has given me to teach about this, those of you who are seriously interested, you will hear this. And those who are simply interested in not being discipled but a rapture date will not see this video. So praise the Lord for those who will. Linda R., Father, right now in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, I pray for Linda R. right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, we come in agreement and pray for her. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the Lord is telling me to tell you, God is exalted and Satan is defeated and Jesus Christ is Lord. That's like from the song, Carmen has a song that says that, you know, God is exalted, Satan is defeated and Jesus Christ is Lord. The Lord rules and reigns. The Lord wants you to know He rules and reigns over the affairs of men. Just like in the book of Daniel. The message of the book of Daniel is, or the theme of the book of Daniel is, God's sovereignty over the kingdoms of man. And the Lord wants you to know He is sovereign over the thoughts and intents of man. Even though God doesn't always intervene, He allows things to happen. But ultimately, whenever He wants to, whenever He needs to, all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to His purposes. God can intervene. God allows Obama to be president. God allowed all the rulers of the world to be there. He can remove them anytime, just like He did with Nebuchadnezzar. Read the story of how God dealt with Nebuchadnezzar and Daniel. God is sovereign over the affairs of men. It's just that He allows things to go forward. And then when He intervenes, we call it a miracle. God, you know, God doesn't do it all the time, or it wouldn't be a miracle. It would be, God would be micromanaging His creation. He doesn't do that. For whatever reason, He allows things to go forward, and then He intervenes in His wisdom that we don't know the beginning from the end. God does. Sister Linda R. Kevin W. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, Father, we give You the praise. We exalt Your holy name. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Kevin W., the Lord wants you to know that He is the Christ, the Son of the living God, the firstborn among many brethren. He's the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is highly exalted and worthy to be praised. Brother Kevin W., in Jesus' name, Father, we praise You. Kathy, Father, right now in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray for Sister Kathy. There's a Bible verse the Lord's given me, and I can't think of the whole Bible verse, but it's, grace and peace comes by Jesus Christ. I can't remember the first part of the Bible verse. Lord, help me in Jesus' name. It's, I believe it's from John chapter 1, and I think it's saying that, the, you know, the law came by Moses, and then the grace and peace came through Jesus Christ. I believe that's John chapter 1, Sister Kathy. I can't think of the verse. I know that some studious followers of my videos, it's usually the same one or two, and I'm thinking of a certain individual from North Carolina who will probably be diligent to post the verse for you to see below this. You can eastward that Bible verse. I'm sorry. Sister Beth P., right now in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we pray for Beth P., Lord God. We ask, Lord, for Your wisdom, Lord, Your guidance. Hallelujah. Father, we give You the praise. And the Lord is just talking to me about a spirit of loveliness. Beth P., a spirit of loveliness. Father, we give you the praise and glory in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray for Beth P. right now, Lord God. And I hear the Lord say, diligence, or due diligence. Due diligence. Now, you know, people ask me if I give them one word, you know, what does that mean? You got to look it up, Google it, meditate on it, and ask the Lord to give you more, because the Lord can speak to you also. You know, it's just a matter of praying, seeking His face. The Bible says, the Lord says in Jeremiah 33:3, call upon me and I will answer you and show you great mighty things that you know not. Beth, due diligence and a lovely, what did I say? Spirit of loveliness. Let's see. Brandy. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we pray for Sister Brandy right now, Lord God. Lord, we ask for your grace and mercy for Sister Brandy. Father, we just honor you. We just praise you right now, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. And I just keep seeing an ear. Sister Brandy, I just keep seeing an ear. I see an ear. Hallelujah, Father. We give you the praise and the glory in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And sight. And I just hear the Bible verse. I mean, I saw ear, and then I hear the Bible verse where the blind man, you know, came to the Lord and kept calling out to him. He said, what can I do for you? He said, that we might receive our sight. And the Lord said to them, do you believe that I can do this? And they said, yes, Lord. He said, let it be according unto you, to your belief. So, sister, you know, maybe you're believing for some kind of healing. But the Lord showed me an ear, and then he gave me that Bible verse about a sight. So maybe you have some hearing trouble or whatever. But we're going to pray right now in Jesus' name for your healing. And I ask everyone to pray in agreement with me. And also, if you need to be healed for something else, let's pray in agreement, brothers and sisters. The Bible says, you know, the prayer of faith will heal the sick. It's from James chapter 5. I believe it's verse 16, 17, 18, whatever. I can't remember. Verse 16. The prayer of faith will heal the sick. Let's pray together right now. Father, right now in the name of Jesus Christ, we're praying for the healing of Sister Brandy and any and all who need to be physically, spiritually, or mentally healed right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we just come in agreement for their healing, Lord. Your word says, by the stripes of Jesus, we were healed. And right now, Father, I decree, declare, and command all bodies, all minds, all mental problems, all hearing problems, all sight problems, all physical problems. Right now, I command thee to come in agreement with the word of God that by the stripes of Jesus we were healed. Right now, be thou whole, be thou clean, be thou healed in Jesus' name. Right now, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. If you've been healed, put a message on here. The Bible says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now, Jesus, go study. If you have a faith problem, read Mark 11, 22, 23, and 24. Go read that. Go read that text. Go read it. I want you to go read it. Mark 11, 22, 23, and 24. The words of Christ. Amber Hall. Reminds me of the Amber Room that is missing. That was stolen. I guess that was during World War I or World War II. Let's pray right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you the praise and the glory, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for Sister Amber Hall. Lord, we just speak victory, victory, victory in Jesus' name. The Lord said he's giving you the victory. That's a good word. I love when I get words like that. The Lord said he's giving you the victory. He's giving you the victory right now. You just receive it, Amber Hall. The Lord is giving you the victory right now in the name of Jesus. Over the world, the flesh, and the devil, death, hell, and the grave. The Lord has given you the victory. The victory is yours. You need to begin to sing, victory is mine, victory is mine, victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind, victory today is mine. Hallelujah. You know, if you guys have been watching my videos, you know that I was the only, you know, the Lord was preparing me for the Philippines. I helped start a black church. I was the only white person in there. And what's the difference between, you know, historically white church and historically black church where I'm from? I guess it's the same all over the U.S. They don't use hymnals or anything like that, and which is cool. You know, and then, you know, your Pentecostal churches and all that are modern churches. They'll have it up on the, you know, up with a projector and all that. But in the black churches I went to, and the one I helped start, they would just spontaneously start singing, you know, and then everyone would join in, and they would sing one song to the next. And so that's where I learned that song, and I don't know that much about the song, but I heard it there, I learned it there, and I don't know if it's sung widely or not. I've never tried to use the Google and see if that song is used anywhere else, but it's a good song. It's called Victory Is Mine, I guess, is the name. I don't even know what's the origin of the song, but it's a good song. Maya L, M-Y-A-L. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we come in agreement and pray for Maya L. Father, we give you the praise, we give you the glory right now, Lord, for the victory, Lord, that we all have through Christ Jesus, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah. And for Maya L, I hear two things. I hear the little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. So in other words, if you have any... You know, Jesus used that to talk about, you know, false religion or the Pharisees and all that. So if you try to bring in, you know, Phariseeism or Judaism and Judaizing and trying to bring in, you know, trying to follow the law and all that or any kind of a false doctrine, you know, it ruins the whole, your whole relationship with the Lord. So a little leaven is leaven the whole lump. And the Lord is speaking to me too. These L's, you know, I guess because your last name is L. Leg. I don't know if you have any trouble with your leg too or... You know, sometimes it can be literal, sometimes it can be spiritual. But I hear the word leg. And then about this, you know, a little leaven at the whole lump. So there's lots of L's in there. But that's how the Lord will do, you know. He likes to do plays on words and everything else too. So Maya, what you need to do is you need to, you know, if that's for you or something you're dealing with, you know, don't get involved in any kind of a false religion like the Judaizers, the Hebrews root movement to an extreme. You know, sacred namers and dressing up in Jewish garb. And, you know, as a matter of fact, there's a guy on YouTube, you know, who just found out recently that he has a Jewish origin. And he was raised as a Christian, no biblical training, no Bible college, no nothing. Starts wearing a yarmulke and a prayer shawl and learned a few Hebrew words. Next thing you know, people think he's some kind of a Hebrew scholar. You know, people lose their mind. They get off into way wacky stuff. But, you know, thank the Lord, over time, these things get exposed. The Lord exposes these things. But it just takes time. And anyway, Darby. Right now, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for Darby. Hallelujah, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah, I just speak right now. Grace, grace, grace. I hear the word for you, Darby, is grace. Where sin abounds, grace does more abound. The grace of God. The grace of God is there for you. You've got it. He's given it. That's what it means. Grace means unmerited, unearned favor. You've got God's grace. It's there for you. Receive. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works. Lest any man should boast. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Linda K. Father, right now we pray for Linda K. in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you the praise and glory in the name of Jesus. Linda K. And the Lord is speaking to me about the word squatter. So, you know, I'm thinking of a squatter can have different meanings, but for me, a squatter is someone that occupies somebody's property without paying for it. You know, someone is like squatting on you. Or, you know, like squatting on your land or squatting in your family. Maybe you have an adult child that won't go away or a relative that won't go away. I don't know what's going on. But the word I hear is squatter. Someone is squatting on you. So let's just pray. I ask you guys to come to agree and pray for Linda K. Father, right now in the name of Jesus Christ, we give you the praise and the glory in the name of Jesus, Lord. We pray for Sister Linda K. to have the victory in this situation. Father, that you will move a mountain in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. We give you the praise and the glory right now, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Father, we honor you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the Lord is just telling me that he's, you know, we're praying for you, the Lord is saying, that you have wisdom to deal with the squatter. You know, someone is squatting on you and using you, and you need to treat them as a squatter. In other words, you need to, you know, move them away from you. And that's from the Lord Jesus Christ. The word is, the Lord sees this person as a squatter. Go Google it and look it up. For me, in the Philippines, like, we have these areas where people go and stay that don't own the place. They call it squatter, and they got something called squatter's rights. In the Philippines, if the squatters keep squatting on your land, and then you don't make a move in a certain amount of time, then they can, like, claim your land. Oh, we've been here for 10 years or 20 years. It's kind of like an easement thing, you know. We've been here a long time, and nobody's done anything about it, so we're just claiming that we own this land, like, you know, claiming a stake to it. It's like that. All right, Dan. Father, right now we pray for Dan in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Father, we give you the praise and the glory in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And I hear the word river. River. So, Dan, river for me represents the Holy Spirit. You know, our baptism. Either baptism in water or baptism in Holy Spirit. River of living water, you know, one of those two or both. River of living water. Out of your belly would flow rivers of living water. That's what I'm hearing now from the Lord. Out of your belly would flow rivers of living water. John chapter 7. It's baptism in the Holy Spirit. Overflow with the Holy Spirit. Speak it in tongues. Receive it in Jesus' name. And if you have, build up your most holy faith praying in the Spirit. That's praying in the tongues to yourself. Between mysteries between you and the Lord. And pray for interpretation. And sometimes the Lord will give you interpretation. It's not for the public, but between you and the Lord. Ida. Father, right now we pray for Ida in the name of Jesus. Father, we give you the praise and the glory. Hallelujah. For Ida in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, we praise you in the name of Jesus for Ida, Lord, Sister Ida. Father, we just thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah for Ida. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we give you the praise. And I believe the last name is starts with a C, Ida C. Hallelujah. I believe that's right. Sister Ida, hallelujah. Father, we give you the praise and the glory right now in Jesus' name. Father, we give you the praise and the Lord and glory in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I just keep hearing the word saith. And the Lord's not adding to that. I hear the word saith. And I'm just waiting on the Lord to tell me something more. Ida, it's saith. It's the word I'm getting from the Lord. Like, you know, in the King James version of, you know, like, thus saith the Lord, or saith thou. You say it. So I believe it's like for you to say it. You say it. Hallelujah, Father, we give you the praise and glory in the name of Jesus, Lord. I ask you guys to continue to pray for Sister Ida. Hallelujah, for more information, more understanding, more detail. Father, we give you the praise and the glory as we pray for Sister Ida right now. Hallelujah, Father, we praise you in the name of Jesus. I hear the word vowel, vow, like V-O-W, like taking a vow, like a wedding vow or what? So I heard saith, like for you to say something, and a vow, like a wedding vow. You saith, that's what I'm hearing from the Lord. You saith, in a vow or a wedding vow. You know, if you made a vow to the Lord, you know, the Bible says if you're going to make a vow to the Lord and you're not going to keep it, it's better not to say it. So I'm just, you know, I'm just adding that on. The Lord didn't tell me that. Or it's a wedding vow or a vow you made to the Lord, or you want to make a vow or you're making a vow to the Lord. Sister, that's all. If the Lord doesn't tell me anymore, now I don't know. But maybe you made a vow to the Lord that you haven't kept it. Or maybe it's about your marriage, wedding vow. Maybe, you know, it's, we're going to pray for you. I ask everybody to pray for Sister Ida for clarification, understanding, and wisdom. What to do? Because, see, now I'm getting like knowledge, but not a word of knowledge, but not a word of wisdom on how to apply it. Father, right now we pray for Sister Ida, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, hallelujah, and I just see that the Lord, about the Lord's will, you know, that the Lord's will be done in this situation. So I don't know, maybe, you know, maybe in your situation is about your marriage or a vow you made to the Lord or with a marriage, but the Lord's will be done. I mean, that's the wisdom. The Lord is showing me that His will be done. The Lord's will be done, Sister Ida. And if the Lord doesn't tell me more specific, I can't tell you. Let's keep going for a few more minutes. Already 35 minutes. Tom in Canada. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray for Tom in Canada. Lord, we just pray for Tom in Canada, Lord, right now. And I hear that a ship is sailing. Hallelujah. A ship is sailing. Hallelujah, Father, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Father, we give you the praise and glory for your word for our brother Tom in Canada. I hear a ship is sailing. It's like a song about a ship is sailing. I don't know the words exactly. Something about a ship is sailing. Lord, we give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Father, we just want to praise you. We want to honor you, Father. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. Ion. I-O-N. Ian. Or Ian. Father, we pray for Ion in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Father, we give you the glory. We give you the praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. We give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. I hear the name Maximilian, which is pretty bizarre. Maximilian is what I hear. Maybe you need to Google that and see what that means. And who is Maximilian? I don't know how that relates to you. Ian. Father, right now we pray for Brother Ian in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you. We exalt you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just hear this song. I'm captured by your Holy Spirit. Set me apart. Yeah, I haven't heard that in a long time. Let's see. I'm giving it or something into the Father's hand. That's the song, and that's for you, Ian. Set me apart. I give my life into the Potter's hand. That's the name of the song. I give my life into the Potter's hand. That's the song I'm hearing from you, for you, Ian. Tom in Canada. There's a ship sailing, and I don't know what all that means. I want to pray again. I wish I could have time to go with each person. You know what? If you guys would invite me to your place and, you know, we can work it out for me to get there, I can sit down and pray with you, and I don't know how long it would take to go from person to person. Go to a hotel in a region like I did in Dallas. Sit down and talk to several people as a group and even pray for individuals and spend 5 or 10 minutes praying, laying hands and praying for a person. I can get a whole lot more detailed word. This is, you know, doing it this way, I can do it, but I'm trying to go through so many names, you know, and I got to keep moving. I'm already almost at 40 minutes. So you guys, if you really want to get a word from me, you really want to see me, you know, make a way, we can work it out, you know. I can get to your area. People would donate, chip in for my transportation to come to a city. I can stay in a hotel, and then people can come to the conference room like I did in Dallas, and people come, and, you know, and I can pray for you and go on and on and on and lay hands on you and spend, you know, I spent like an hour with each person. And, you know, because people have lots of real problems and real issues, and, you know, the pastors at these mega churches don't have time to talk to anybody. They're just a little bit too much, just a little too special, you know, to take the time to talk to the, you know, the commoners and stuff. But I'll talk to you commoners because I'm also, you know, just a regular, you know, servant of God. And, you know, we're all equal in the eyes of God. And we have different gifts and talents, but we're all, you know, we're all the same. There's no bond, no free, Greek, no poor, you know, and all that. But all are one in Christ. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, message me. Let's set it up. If someone's going to message me, just like I'm going to be in Philadelphia for Labor Day, Memorial Day weekend, say, hey, I want to meet you at the hotel. And then when people meet me, they're going to chip in. I can stay more nights. I can stay in Philadelphia, you know, every night. Let's just say it's like $100 a night, whatever. Approximately, you know, and to eat there and stay, say $100 a night. Chip in people in Philadelphia and say, hey, you know, chip in, you're going to stay for more days, and I'm going to come there and let you, and I'll minister to you. People message me and say, hey, I live in whatever, Memphis. Come on down here. And, you know, and I'll make a video. I could even make a quick video and say, people in the Memphis area, you know, contact and start a, you know, like a group. You guys can talk to each other and say, okay, here, you know, we have a budget of, you know, for you to travel from where you are to Memphis, and then you stay in a hotel for a week, and then we're going to see you, and you're going to, you know, do revival and pray for us, whatever, something like that. There's a sister in Charlotte that's kind of wanting to do something like that. And, you know, I mean, that's what I need to do. You know, the YouTube is awesome, but, you know, it's great when I can meet people in person, too. And there's people that need more intense prayer and all that. Hey, I'm willing to, traveling is not a joy. I mean, traveling to go on vacation is one thing. And then traveling and doing this is not, you know, a personal joy, but my job from God, you know, I have joy in serving the Lord and then getting words for people. I enjoy that. You know what I'm saying? The ministry part of it, the spiritual part is where my joy is. Anyway, guys, I love you guys. I'm already at 40 minutes, and I'm going to get this loaded. I'm going to keep working on a list. I've still got about 30 names, and, you know, they keep coming in, and I'll keep trying to work on it, guys. God bless you guys. Love you guys. Stay ready to meet the Lord. I don't know, man knows the day or the hour. Just stay ready. And by the grace of God, it'll be tomorrow. To live is Christ, to die is gain. Maybe it'll be tomorrow. Maybe it'll be another year. I don't know. But I believe in my spirit that, you know, it's very soon. It's at the door. So God bless you guys and love you guys. And hopefully I'll get to meet each one, every one of you guys. If not now, up there at the Rapture.